Do your walls have the doldrums? Why not fix that with some beautiful original artwork? Give your friends and family something to talk about, ponder, and enjoy. Lavish some beauty on them and yourself. You deserve it. Pamela Beer has helped countless clients find the inspirational piece to evoke just the right memory or feeling to their space. Art consultant Kathy says,
Pam's artwork is uplifting, colorful, and highly imaginative, always providing enjoyment and hope to patients and staff in our many hospitals and clinics. Her sense of joy and her commitment to her sense of color and design just add extra enjoyment to everything she does. Thank you, Pam, for all the healing that your artwork gives to the world.
To learn more, follow or message Pamela on Instagram at Pamela_K_beer or Facebook at Pamela K Beer Art.
Alternative Talk 1150, the talk of the sound.
Welcome back to Real Talk with Brian and Dan on 1150 KKNW.
I'm Brian.
And I'm Dan. Our first guest today is Pamela of Pamela K. Beer Art. Pamela is a contemporary mixed media artist. Her paintings are vivid, colorful, spacious, and often abstract, yet rooted in the simultaneous experience of her Southern heritage and her current life. She makes use of strong lights and darks with distinct forms that imply fond strength and joy. Her work is complex, layered, and evokes a sense of love for the beautiful, whether in relationships, grace, humans, and nature.
Her work begins with, okay, Pam, you sent me,
Asemic.
Okay, I learned a new one.
Asemic
writing form marks, colors, and employs both transparencies and opacities that ebb and flow into the canvas, allowing the viewer to connect with the abstraction of the work, yet finding something familiar. Her paintings are featured in and around Puget Sound. She is a member of the Washington Women Painters, recently selected as a finalist in Cincinnati's premier Art Comes Alive 2019. Shows with the Lynn Hansen Gallery in Seattle, provides work for local hospitals, and presented work at the Seattle Art Fair. She pops up in other galleries in the Northwest. She also blogs and teaches art workshops. And also, I was so blessed to have her utilize my office space for her art. We loved having original art versus just stuff on the walls. That was really fun, Pam. Thank you.
That was great to be able to do that.
Welcome to the show.
Thanks. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So, Pam, we spoke about this in the green room beforehand. We were kind of talking about hobbies and interests, and you have been able to turn your hobby into your passion, which
yes.
is what we're talking about now.
Yes.
So when you're not passionately painting or doing that, what do you do for fun?
Thinking about painting.
Yeah.
Well, I have a Havanese, and people who follow me on Facebook see me post a lot of my little puppy. She keeps me alive. I like to putter around in my garden when it's not raining outside mm-hmm. in the great north wet, and go for motorcycle rides with my husband when he's got his Harley out.
You do have hobbies and interests.
I do have hobbies and interests, but painting is kind of my thing.
Nice.
So are you more of a vegetable and fruit gardener or a flower gardener?
I thought you'd ask about painting.
I like greenery and flowers and just making the yard look nice so that I have something to enjoy, a nice sanctuary space.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
So share a memory of the home you grew up in.
Let's see. I will talk about my grandmother's house because she was an avid gardener, very green thumb, and she had African violets absolutely everywhere.
Oh, fun.
And that was kind of neat. It was a very old house. I remember a lot of autumn color was her thing. And so now I've started to gravitate towards those colors, which is kind of interesting.
That's awesome. So autumn colors would be oranges, browns,
brown, yellow.
Burgundy.
Yellow's my favorite color.
Yellow?
Yeah.
Wow, that would have been a good question. What's your favorite color? Right, for our artists. Yellow is your favorite.
Yellow is my favorite color. Unfortunately, it doesn't hang well for very long for most people. Most people like blue. A lot of people like reds, greens. But I think blue is probably the number one.
I think there'd be a lot to do with the lighting that's available too.
I think so.
That's the first thing with yellow is that can be a hard one in terms of interior lighting.
Yeah. It can be. Although not the way I do it, but, you know, we can talk about that.
So how long have you been an artist?
I have been painting for over 35 years. I didn't start doing this professionally until 2013. And then I started doing it every single day.
How do you come up with your inspiration?
It finds me. I think inspiration's an interesting thing. People sort of expect that we get some great aha moments, but it comes in drips and dribbles. It's like you start on something and you come away sort of stuck or frustrated, or you get to that point where it's like, well, I don't really know what to do, but you just keep showing up every day. You just show up, and sometimes you wake up in the middle of the night and something just hits you, like, you know, out of nowhere. Sometimes you just see it in someone's face, or you talk with someone and they remind you of something. Mm. And then you go back to your studio and just keep working. Just show up every single day. That's the key point.
Yeah, I've heard writers say that, you know,
yeah.
Show up, write every day.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, if you wait for inspiration to hit you before you pick up a tool to start working, you'll wait a long time.
So what do you love most about the work you do?
Well, it's peaceful, fulfilling. There's something lyrical and magical about creating something visual. For me, I'm a very visual person. I love a lot of color. And just being able to do it and enjoy my own company and be in my own headspace is fun and de-stressing. So that's probably the one thing for me personally that I love to do. And I think the other thing about this whole journey that I've gotten out of it that I never thought that I would really get out of it is the connection with other people, the relationships that I've made, the friendships that I've made from working with clients or being able to do this work for someone, getting to know people, because I can't paint for someone unless I really understand who they are and what they love. And it just tickles me when someone sees something that I've made and they love it, and I just get all giddy because that's cool.
So let's talk in the form of houses and art, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of people, it's maybe the last thing they do when they finally move into a home is they kind of select their furniture, they kind of get things situated, you know, they get their TV up, they get all, you know, their dresser where it needs to go, and then it's like, okay, now I'd like to, you know, adorn above this mantle, or I'd like to, this wall needs something. Can they come to you and get something commissioned?
Absolutely. Yes. I am happy to do commissions. I can't do a ton because they take time, but I do a few commissions a year. And I work with people to understand specifically what they are interested in. I like to get to know someone. For example, I'll ask them questions like, send me some pictures or show me the kind of art that you gravitate to, that you love, the things that you enjoy the most. What are the colors that you feel comfortable around? Show me a picture of your space. What do you like to do? Just getting to know people, because ultimately, if I create something for someone, they need to really be inspired by it or really love it. Otherwise, I haven't done my job.
Right.
The way that I want to do it.
Right. And that's so essentially they can end up with something very unique, tailored for their space.
Absolutely.
But also, too, they could look at your current available.
They can. There are quite a few pieces that are currently available. And everything I do has some meaning behind it or some story behind it. And it's okay if it matches your couch. There's nothing wrong with that. And I'm saying that because, you know, I have a lot of artist friends and we get a little weird when people just want to match their couch, because, you know,
it's
art after all.
Yeah. Right.
But it's okay if it enhances the environment in which you place it.
So one of the things that comes to my mind is you have a very unique style. I very much like your style.
Thank you,
but
Brian.
In commission, do they ever want you to really deviate from that, go to directions that you wouldn't typically go?
Well, in my past, I have done a little bit of that, but I don't really do that anymore.
Mm-hmm.
If I feel like it's deviating from my style, like if they want me to paint something you know, like Gauguin or something.
Do a landscape or something.
Do a, you know, yeah. Or something that someone else has done. I know a ton of artists. I'll help you find someone who can do it for you.
Yeah.
I want to do what I'm good at. Mm-hmm. And I think that the next artist needs to do what they're good at. That's what makes it so unique. It's a very, very personal, handmade craft. And it shouldn't be laborious for the artist to make. It should be a joy. Mm-hmm. Because that certainly shows through in everything that an artist does.
So your art is featured in my home. We really love that.
Hey.
You know, every day.
I know. I'm so thrilled.
So what if a person doesn't know the first thing about buying original art? What do they do? How do they learn?
Look at a lot of art.
Yeah.
I mean, just go to places and look at a lot of art. There's Seattle has an art walk first Thursday, Pioneer Square. I happen to be in a gallery down in Pioneer Square area on Washington, the Lynn Hansen Gallery. So I'll plug that again later, too.
Okay,
thanks,
good.
Guys. but Art Walk Thursday is great. A lot of people can go downtown. You can get free parking on Art Walk Thursday in a few of the garages there. And troll the area. Go look at a lot of art. Just look at art. Go visit an artist studio. Or call me. You are welcome to come visit my studio.
Okay.
I promise not to get paint on you. I'll actually give you a little booties to put on your feet so you don't track anything out. Mm. But that's the – and talk to artists. Ask questions. Curiosity is the best way to research. And for heaven's sakes, buy something that speaks to you that you love. Don't buy it because your friends think it's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Don't buy it because it's what you've always bought.
Yeah,
and you can't go wrong if you buy what you love, no matter what the style is, because it'll all go.
Unless it's not what my wife loves.
Well,
yeah, mom's not happy. Nobody's happy.
Yeah.
That's right.
Well, you know, I got to tell you, Dan, buying or making art when you have a husband and wife combination is a pretty interesting and precarious place to be. But
I could imagine.
I got that. I can handle that.
Well, and but, I would defer to her, and I think because she's seen way more than I have. And she has a vision of what she would want things to look like.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll just appreciate it. That's how we function.
You're a good husband.
he's a keeper.
I think you're a keeper.
Hey, you hear that, Lisa? All right, yeah. I'm a keeper.
So how does a person know they're getting good quality, enduring art?
Well, you look at the art. And I think light is a great it's a teller of how well something is made when it's under the proper lighting. You can see, you should be able to see some depth in it. You should be able to see that the colors are not harsh, but yet blend together. The edges and the sides of the piece, the way it's framed and presented, should be clean and elegantly made.
So, Pamela, I've got a couple of your pieces here in front of me. And one of them is kind of a soft with blue edges and kind of gray and green in the middle, and then another one has more linear lines on it.
Mm-hmm.
So why the – tell me about the difference between those two kind of – I'm describing it on the radio. It's hard to see.
But it's radio.
Yeah.
Well, the one that's got the burgundy in it with the white and kind of more linear.
Yes.
That is from a series.
I remember that series.
That's from a series about the capstone, about cornerstones and capstones, reference points for our lives.
Hmm.
There's a whole history around that. There's history in the church. There's history in England about that. And we use capstones in architecture.
Mm-hmm.
So that was that particular series. And in that whole series, there are sort of that feel of raw stone or capstones or, you know, edges to things. And then the other piece that you're showing is called A Blue Mist. And that's more of a grouping of paintings that is kind of more about a dream state. It's more about a place of just existing in the space between a very peaceful, relaxing, yet there's, in that particular piece, there's a lot of scumbling and scratching, that acemic writing, that that word that stumped Brian earlier.
Yeah, yeah.
Acemic means it's nonsensical writing, but it's like if you know artists, it's like a Cy Twombly kind of started that, you know, with a lot of scribbling and everything. Hmm. But it's just my natural hand. It's very personal, and it doesn't have to mean anything in particular. But
yeah, it's like my art would definitely be a simic.
I
would pick that mode.
We need to talk.
All right. So what mediums and tools are you working with?
Well, I'll give you a little tiny bit of background if we have a minute or two. But
We do.
I started in watercolor, which is the most challenging medium to begin in because it's very unforgiving. And that was actually how I learned to paint, was watercolor years and years ago. And I can, you know, I can kind of tell you how I got started if we have time for that, too.
Sure.
But we do?
We do.
A little bit of time. I'll tell you a little story. So when my daughter was about two, and I worked at night, and my husband worked during the day, and he traveled a lot. And he went out of town and was gone for a couple of weeks, and I'd get bored looking for things to do. What do you do with a two-year-old? And so, you know, mm-hmm. you play with your two-year-old, and you color, and you draw, and all that. And then finally they wear out and they take a nap. And then you're like, oh great. Now what do I do? Yay. So my mom had come to visit and she'd left a box of craft paint because she was quite the crafter. My neighbor had given me a box of paints and brushes. And I thought, oh, what am I going to do with this? Let's see what I can do. And I found a magazine in the box. There was a Gauguin painting in the magazine. So I copied it.
Wow.
And my husband came home and he saw that and he goes, we're going to the art store. And I said, but honey, we're poor. We just bought this house. We got no money. We're eating beans and weenies, right? We're feeding a new baby. So how do we do this? He goes, I don't care. We're going to the art store. So we go to the art store and the lady in the art store says, well, okay, well, let me get you started over here with this oil paint and this brush and all this. And I go, ma'am, I am broke. I cannot afford to do this. She said, well, watercolor paper isn't that expensive. This was, mind you, 35 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And watercolor paints are relatively affordable. So why don't you start with watercolor? So that's what I started with. Little did I know that was the most challenging and most unforgiving medium.
Oh, geez.
However, it was great training.
Yeah.
So I did tons and tons of watercolors for about 10, 15 years. And then I switched to acrylic. And then, always working with brushes or dripping, pouring paint, different ways of getting it onto the canvas. And then a few years ago, I started painting on wood panel. And then last year, I took a class in oil and cold wax, combining the two, which is somewhat different for a different effect. And it makes the paint a little bit translucent, so the layers get very beautiful and you get a lot of optical color changes. And I started working with that, and I don't use a brush at all. I actually use brayers, which is like a little roll spongy. It's not spongy, but it's like a soft roller in different sizes to put the paint on. And then I use these squeegee tools. They're kind of like, you know, silicone bowl scrapers like you use in the kitchen.
Interesting.
And I use a lot of, a medium to get it to drip and do different things to get a different effects. And it's very experimental, but what I love about it is it allows me to do lots and lots of layers. I have an idea of where I'm going, but I don't know exactly where I'll end up. So it's always a surprise to me as well, which makes it terrifically fun.
Right.
So I hope that wasn't too long.
No, that's good. So wood panels. So Steve...
My husband makes the panels,
nice.
Yes.
And he's enthusiastic about that?
He is wonderful. He loves it. I mean, I could go buy them, and I told him when we first started, honey, I'll go buy these panels. He goes, no, I really want to make them. So he makes them, and they're better than what we can
get
at
gorgeous.
The store.
Yeah.
He does a beautiful job, and then we just finish the nice wood edges with, you know, a little bit of wax or a little bit of furniture polish, and they look very nice.
Yeah.
So where can people see your work?
Well, they can see my work in a number of places. Thursday night is Art Walk Thursday, Pioneer Square, Lynn Hansen Gallery. I've got two gorgeous large pieces. One of them is the sample there of the blue one.
Okay.
And the other one is this hot magenta, which is gorgeous. And I'm also in a couple of other places. Actually, if you go to my website at PamelaKBeer.com, there's an events tab on there, And all my events are listed for where I'm showing. So I work in Camino, I have peace in Tacoma, and Women Painters of Washington. I have some birds, because I also do little birds for the holidays.
So how else can people get in contact? You get the website?
Instagram. Okay. They can direct message me through my Instagram account. They can also follow me on Facebook. And my website has, they can connect with me through my website.
Mm-hmm. And we'll be featuring on this segment, when we send that to you, we'll be featuring your art on there.
Cool.
So the visual will be there for our listeners if you want to take a look at that, and that'll be available. So, Pam, thank you so much for joining us today.
Wonderful. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it. Oh, wait.
No, that's it. So after the break, we're going to have our mortgage moment.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that was a little change. We're going to have Wes Graham, who's a loan consultant with Washington First Mortgage, right after this break. Thanks for coming on, Pam.